to me. Talk to me. If you feel the need or when you need the feeling, talk to me. If you feel the need or when you need the feeling, talk to me.
They say what happens in Las Vegas stays in Las Vegas, but this week we're going to tell you everything that's happening in this electrifying American town that never seems to know how to slow down. Hello everyone, I'm Timothy Goh. Welcome to another episode of That's IT. This week we're coming to you from America's town of fun and entertainment. We're here in Las Vegas to check out what the buzz is all about at the 2007 International Consumer Electronics Show. So stay here on That's IT because the next 30 minutes will be all about the latest offerings in consumer electronics.
When the Consumer Electronics Show started in New York City in 1967, there were only two hot ticket items. Can you guess what they were? Color TVs and transistor radios. Fast forward 40 years on, and today the CES has become the biggest consumer electronics gathering in the world. This year, nearly 200,000 people participated in Las Vegas. And literally thousands of gadgets and gizmos were on show. The show is spread out in not just one exhibition center, but in four different convention venues around the famed Las Vegas Strip. And a handful of hotel suites had to be converted into showrooms just to house the thousands of exhibitors showing off their latest wares. When it comes to being big, Las Vegas knows what it's doing. Organizers say the total exhibition area is upwards of 1.7 million square feet, or roughly the size of 35 American football fields. The International CES is the place to be for any techies who want to be in the know. Just make sure you got the right shoes on.
Innovation is the buzzword at the International CES this year, and it was just a dozen years ago when Microsoft was here to launch Windows 95 and Office 95. Remember the impact that made on personal computing? Well, it seems history is poised to repeat itself.
The biggest story at the International CES 2007 is the Microsoft Vista. The much-anticipated and improved operating system was unveiled here and will be made available to the rest of the world by the end of the month. I had a rare one-on-one with Microsoft CEO Steve Ballmer, and obviously, the guy is very proud of his new baby.
I think Windows Vista will be a big, big deal for the computer industry and for consumers and businesses around the world. It'll be right up there with Windows 95. That was certainly a huge impact, and there's every bit as much or more innovation, frankly, in Windows Vista, whether it's for the consumer, for photos, for videos, for the new user interface, I think is fantastic, for security, for businesses. So I think it's just a huge deal.
Okay, but there are some concerns with the Windows XP and all the viruses and the bugs with it. What are you doing with security for the Vista?
We've done really three things that are important. Number one, we built Vista on a kind of a new development process that has a whole lot more architectural focus on security. So it will be by far the most secure version of Windows that we've ever done, and the highest quality overall, fewest defects. Number two, we've built in a number of new technologies designed to help Windows protect itself from attack. And number three, we ourselves are releasing add-on products that are designed to supplement the security that comes built into Windows. Now, there's still bad guys out there, and we're going to have to continue to be diligent. The bad guys aren't going to go away, and there will be issues. But I guarantee you this will be the most secure version we've ever had.
Well, these bad guys are always one step ahead of you guys. Are you going to be two steps ahead of them with the Vista?
I don't think the bad guys are usually ahead, and I think, you know, it's one of these things where the good guys need to be right all the time, and the bad guys only need to be right one of the time. And it's a little bit like physical security. If somebody wants to break in your house, they can. What you have to do is to try to make it more difficult for them, And of course, we've been working with law enforcement to also make it more painful if bad guys do bad things.
Okay, let's talk about the upgrading to the Vista. What about the existing people who are using the XP? What sort of hardware? Is it going to be hard for them to upgrade to the Vista?
Statistically, if this is like any other transition in Windows releases, most people who get Windows Vista will actually get it on new computers. Okay. We're going to sell a lot of upgrades to people on their existing computers, but statistically, 90%+ of the people who get Vista will choose to get a new computer when they get it. That's just the kind of the mindset. If I'm going to change my computer, fine. If not, I'll stay the same. Now, with that said, we will literally sell millions of upgrades, and we've made it much easier to upgrade than it ever has been before, from an old version of Windows to a new version of Windows. But we do recommend people get our upgrade advisor and kind of check compatibility, hardware, system resources before they take that path.
Microsoft has big expectations with the Vista, as it is positioned to become the dominant OS as early as its launch. The Vista's full potential will only be realized, though, when the software is coupled with an equally powerful hardware. And Intel has the answer for that. Two heads are better than one, as they say, and that is exactly what the Intel Core Duo 2 is all about. With the Core Duo 2, we, multitasking experts, can finally perform dozens of functions in our computers without the slowdown.
It's a dual-core microprocessor, so it has two brains in it. And we're working with the software industry so that they can take advantage of two cores and actually do twice as much work in using both of those brains. And now we have quad-core processors, so we're adding more and more brains to the microprocessor, so more and more work can be done and also not use as much power.
And since we're on the topic of innovations that can change our lives, take a look at this. Samsung and Boston Scientific partnered up recently and are in the process of developing an MP3 player for the hearing impaired. They are hoping a Bluetooth-enabled bionic ear implant will allow the deaf to start enjoying music from a Bluetooth-enabled MP3 player like Samsung's.
One of the real losses when you go deaf is the loss of music. Even if you weren't a big audiophile, you lose music and then you know how much it meant to you. For years, we've been able to plug directly into stereos or other kinds of MP3 players and what have you, and pump it directly into the cochlear implant, but that still wasn't a great quality sound. It was very monochromatic. What Samsung has done, working with Boston Scientific, Boston Scientific's come out with this new product, this new processor that has the computing power to make music more palatable, and Samsung is working on the delivery of those sounds to the implant. And we have an MP3 player with the Bluetooth headphones, and that's right now, but into the future, what's going to happen and what you're going to see is product development for cochlear implants that will basically Bluetooth enable them. I think that's the long-term goal, where you don't have the headphones. You just have the MP3 and you can click and hear music, hear phones, hear everything else, and have it be very high quality sound.
Have you had enough yet? Well, I'm just getting started. So when we return, I'll show you my favorite discoveries on the exhibition floor. That's IT in Las Vegas. We'll be right back.
Talk to me. Tonight, a look at Thailand's young people. Despite better living standards, there are more and more disenfranchised youth. Find out why on Primetime News.
I like the way you move.
He's a hip-hop singer who idolizes not stars, but Sun Wukong.
西游记第一次我看了一个翻译成英文的一本书叫 Monkey.
Despite his growing fame, he remains true to his passion of hip-hop. Come back with Jeremy as he reveals his struggles and success. Only in China. Thursday at 7:30 p.m. And astute ladybug. With a worker from hell, a brand new dynamic duo is coming to town. No matter where you're from, they will go all out to accomplish every single task. Made to Order 3 debuts tomorrow, 8 p.m. only on Channel 8.
Thursday. His employees run the business when he's out of the country. Her staff take their destinies into their own hands. Leaders who drive work-life policies, what are they made of?
When you can create an environment where they feel that they're working more with another family, this is one of the strongest retention tools that we can have.
Find out on Work Life Works, Thursday at 8:30 p.m.
This program is presented by the Tripartite Committee on Work-Life Strategy and supported by the Ministry of Manpower.
Talk to me.
Have you ever imagined what it feels like to be on this side of That's IT? The best part of my job is I get to experience all the innovations even before they hit the store shelves. So now we're going to have a look at a handful of my favorites.
In the last 40 years, the International CES has been a place that launched products we now can't live without. And it continues to be the place where you can get to see gadgets you don't even know you need yet. This year, the flat-screen TV moves ahead. It didn't just get bigger and flatter, it also comes with more features. Samsung unveiled a prototype of what it calls a Wi-Fi plasma TV. This one right here will function without all the connecting cables we're all used to. All you have to do is plug the cables in the set-top box, and you can hang this plasma in any room in your house.
So it'll go through doors, you can have it on the other side, you can have it in your living room and have your TV in your family room, and it'll transmit all the way over there.
And that's not all. This Wi-Fi TV can also hook up to your PC wirelessly to let you enjoy watching your favorite YouTube video clips. To ease consumer confusion, LG launched a Super Multi Blue Player. This thing right here is an advanced dual-format high-definition disc player that will allow us to play both HD DVD and Blu-ray DVD formats. So while both high-definition DVD formats battle out for supremacy, LG is already giving us the machine that will play both, minus the headache. iPod may not be part of the massive international CES, but products made for the iPod surely made a big impression. ViewSonic showcased its video iPod docking station, ViewDock. This time, mounted on a high-definition front projection panel, the PJ258D brings new digital options for video iPod users. But wait a minute. Video iPod is a low-resolution download. When played in a big screen projection, wouldn't the quality deteriorate drastically?
Well, you know, there's a resolution compromise with this. This particular projector is an XGA projector, so it'll do 1024 by 768 resolution. You can download content 640 by 480, so there's a little bit of a compromise. But the digital content that we show, we're showing some movies that we've downloaded, looks really quite good. And this projector serves more than just an iPod dock projector. This projector serves as an entertainment projector. It also serves as a data projector. So you can hook up a number of products into these inputs in the back and show a lot of higher definition products or HD content, whether it be games with your PlayStation or your 360 or your PC games, or you can connect it to other DVD players or otherwise and then project that content as well as your video content. And there's really not that much of a compromise when you're looking at a 640 by 480. That's what the output is from a DVD player, so it looks pretty good.
And then this also caught my eye for those of you who love to sing in the shower. Now you can give your iPod an ego.
This is the ego waterproof case. You know, you got to have your ego. And with Eagle, you have a bulletproof, it's made of the same material bulletproof glass is made from. So it's very strong. If you use it by the ocean, it's not going to etch with salt. What it is for your iPod. You'll fit any of the formats of iPod, video, nano, etc. And what you do is you set it into it, into the piece. You lock it in place, it becomes waterproof. We have a waterproof, float in your pool. You can go swimming, you'll hear the sound, you'll hear your music underwater as you're swimming.
In just 2.5 hours away by plane in San Francisco, Apple unveiled what we've all been expecting. This handsome thing right here is tentatively named the iPhone, pending a lawsuit. Apparently the name iPhone is a trademark owned by Cisco. So for the sake of this feature, let's just call it the Apple Phone. The sleek Apple Phone combines the music and video functions of the iPod with the communication functions of a mobile smartphone. I just wonder why Steve Jobs decided to hold his Apple World at the same time as CES. But outside it, is he trying to steal the thunder away from Bill Gates' Vista glory moment? And since Mr. Jobs announced its smartphone slayer, this will be a good segment to briefly tell you about the thing that was touted initially as the iPod killer. Take a look at the Microsoft Zoom. It's a good music and video player, however, unlike the iPod, the Zoom can't be used as a hard drive and has limited Wi-Fi capabilities. Bottom line, it's not quite an iPod killer just yet.
While Las Vegas is the center of the consumer electronics universe, at least in the next few days, something else major is happening back at home. It ain't easy being in two places at one time, but beam me up, Scotty.
The day of the CES's opening, Nokia launched with much fanfare yet another two phones they feel are destined to change our lives even more. These additions to Nokia's N series are meant to reinforce the company's vision of mobilizing the internet, letting us use our multimedia devices to create, consume, and share our experiences wherever and whenever. The N93i has all the bells and whistles we're familiar with from the N series, and then some. With a 1 GB mini SD card, you can shoot and store up to 45 minutes of DVD-like quality video or up to 1,250 still photos. It comes with Vox, a video and photo blogging service that lets you share photo and video stories in its original size. The N76 is the more elegant of the two, of course, so slim, it's almost sexy. It probably takes the prize in any comparison on size to feature ratios. It has a 2-megapixel camera, games, and doubles up as a fully loaded music player.
Both are for technology leaders because NCDS is targeting technology leaders, and both are targeted to technology leaders, so both are multimedia computers, and both are to be used for internet, and both are designed to enable Web 2.0 use. However, this is more focused in video, and this is more focused in style concern technology users.
Well, all that beaming up and down sure isn't easy. I just wish I was really beamed here instead of taking that 20-hour flight. Coming up next, more innovations from the International Consumer Electronics Show here in Las Vegas.
Talk to me.
Tonight, a look at Thailand's young people. Despite better living standards, there are more and more disenfranchised youth. Find out why on Primetime News.
From now till 17th February 2007, you could get spotted and be a winner as well. Always remember to wave to say thanks, signal early, give way to other motorists and pedestrians, don't cut queues, road hog or tailgate.
要礼让的精神，安全是第一。
Yes, and I think it will make the roads much more enjoyable to ride, much safer.
Road courtesy, pass it on. Have a pleasant journey.
Workfare bonus as a cash
income
payment.
There will be something there and it's to
we will have something
GST.
For the middle income.
It's to raise their productivity through skills upgrading
small
and
small restoration to the CPI.
We decided better be upfront with Singaporeans.
sudden death occurs without warning and has claimed more lives. What can we do about it? Insight takes you deeper into this medical mystery. Sudden Death Syndrome on Insight, tonight at 9:30.
Talk to me.
Welcome back to That's IT in Las Vegas. Well, of course, there are some consumer electronic products that we need for basic survival, and there are stuff that we just want for our own pleasure. So now let's indulge in some high-end, high-performance products.
If you have the money to spare, then why not spare some for these high-end, or rather high-performance products, as they are called here in Las Vegas? First up, take a look at this Halo amplifier by Parasound. Elegant yet delivers impeccably crisp sound for the serious audiophile. Experts told me this entire line by Halo incorporates professional audio technologies in a package suitable for your private listening pleasure, and the pièce de résistance at this high-performance show floor at the Venetian would have to be this. Avid's $19,000 turntable, the Acutis. Why is it so pricey? One look and you'll know the engineering that went into the production of this is extraordinary.
With our products particularly, if it's an exceptionally good recording, you'll very much hear that. If it's a very bad recording, it will let you know. That's a major difference between other turntables where you can put either a good or a bad record and it will sound pretty much all the same. What we've done, the way we manufacture our turntables, is that you get exactly what is on the record, and the quality of what's on the record you actually will hear.
And then there's the chassis that rests on so-called active suspension. Tap the turntable and it won't disrupt the music. Now that is pure magic.
So what do you find in between products that you need and the stuff that you want? What about electronics that would raise your eyebrows?
What about a 3D TV screen? LG engineers created this prototype hoping one day we may get to enjoy the wonders of 3D in our own home without the dorky red and blue glasses. LG's 3D TV uses 25 perspective views just to show one image. It may look fun for now, but imagine having to watch TV like this all the time? No thanks. And of course there is Asimo. We've met her a few times before, and every time she shows up, there is something new in her arsenal.
It's nice to see you too, Tiffany.
So, Asimo, welcome again to CES.
Thank you. I feel like a new robot.
Asimo can sidestep continuously. 2.7.
This is Asimo's US debut, and she is running faster than ever before. She can even run in circles and dance to your heart's content. Honda engineers are hoping one day Asimo can help people in need, especially the disabled.
So many things to look forward to in 2007. I'm just so glad we made the trip to Vegas. Now, if only I can be beamed back home. I'll work on that. Meantime, if you'd like to find out what else we discovered here in Las Vegas, do check us out at channelnewsasia.com/thatsit. I'm Timothy Goh. That's it. Time for me to go home. Hello everyone, I'm Timothy Goh. Welcome to another episode of That's IT. This week we're going to talk about creative works in the digital format.
you want to be transported away, forget about the magic carpet, because this time, it's all done in the click of a mouse.
The computer is an art studio in itself, for those who know where to look and how to use it. The revolution spawned by the triple play of the computer, software, and the internet affects every aspect of contemporary life. It also allows people around the world to share ideas, images, and sounds almost instantaneously. A new breed of artists has embraced these cutting-edge technologies. They're using them to exploit and explore visual possibilities.
Digital art is art that features the use of digital media as opposed to traditional fine art like painting and sculpture. And a lot of times they use, well, in the common sense word, computers and computer processes. And the point of digital art is that it's not just another medium. It's using these computers or digital media to allow the audience or the visitor to see things that they otherwise would not have been able to see and to experience.
It should come as no surprise to anyone these days, computers are capable of producing pretty powerful graphic images. In fact, computer-generated imagery is a burgeoning art movement, and it's rapidly changing the landscape of contemporary art. Cyber artists are explorers in a digital world, seeking new trails and new discoveries. They're laying the foundation for digital art to become a dominant force in contemporary art.
You'll find that the canvas, in a sense, where you use new media art, can be a flat piece of wall. It can be a curved surface, like the rotunda. We've even done digital projections on the facade of our building for special events. It basically liberates the artist from the confines of a traditional canvas with a frame that you hang on the wall. So the level of creativity is completely different when you are talking about digital art.
No wonder the 21st century canvas is all about the ready accessibility of computers, software, and the internet. Once upon a time, not so long ago, digital art ran counter to the role of art as a commodity. Purists saw digital as something difficult to make rare. After all, the computer does it all for you, and the image created could be infinitely repeatable. Today, the digital canvas is gaining the regard once reserved for serious art form, like sculpture, painting, and drawing.
It's the use of computers and computer technology. And with Suzanne Victor's swinging chandelier installation, Contours of a Rich Maneuver, it is a chance to see how traditional art form, in this case sculpture, you know, her chandeliers, can give you a new experience, because the sculptures are choreographed. They swing in a certain kind of pattern, in fact in over 10 different kinds of pattern, and it's really amazing. And it is only achievable when you realize because she has used computer technology and computer programming to in such an extent that she can control down to the second the unique movement of each and every chandelier. And it is this computer programming that allows the chandeliers to swing in like 10 different formations. So this is another type of digital.